تنصروه فقد نصره الله.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، أما بعد. Inshallah, we're beginning with the first dars in the series that we had on the sharh of Umdatul Fiqh. And we're benefiting from the ahadith from Umdatul Ahkam. As a short recap on these two very important books, we'll be following the matan of Umdatul Fiqh, which is written by Muwaffaq al-Din ibn Qudama. Al-Imam Muwaffaq al-Din ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi al-Hanbali, the famous scholar, the author of Al-Umda, which is the book we're studying here, and of Al-Mukni', which is the next level book, and Al-Kafi', which is after that, and Al-Mughni, which is from the greatest books of fiqh ever written. Al-Shaykh Abdul Aziz ibn Baz, rahmatullah alayh, he was asked, what is the greatest book of fiqh ever written? And he said, the greatest book of fiqh ever written is Al-Mughni. He mentioned some other books that are excellent, but he said the best of them, Al-Mughni. So this Ibn Qudama, he is also the author of the book Lum'at al-I'tiqad that we study in Aqidah. He was a great scholar of Islam from Sham, originally from Bayt al-Maqdis, and that's why he's called Al-Maqdisi, from the blessed land of the Anbiya, Palestine. But he taught in Damascus, may Allah free Sham and make its ahwal better. And he was from the greatest scholars of the Hanabila, from the two Shaykhan, one being Majduddin ibn Taymiyyah, the grandfather of Taqiyuddin ibn Taymiyyah, and the other being Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudama. The other book we're benefiting from in support is the book Umdatul Ahkam, written by his cousin Abdul Ghani al-Maqdisi, which is a book of hadith about ahkam only from Bukhari and Muslim. We are in the chapter of Sifatul Salah. And this chapter is a very important chapter because every one of us has to make salah. Every one of us. It is fardul ayn upon every Muslim to make salah. Even if somebody has times like al-hayd or nifas where they don't, the time will pass, they will have to go back to making salah. And everybody thinks they know how to make salah. But many times, if you ask somebody, why do you do this in salah? They will tell you, because my father did it that way, my mother did it that way, my grandmother, the people in my masjid. But those people are not a dalil. They're not a proof. Sometimes they've read only one little book or a risala and they think they know everything about salah. And the salah is the most important of the physical actions of Islam. Yani after the aqidah, after the shahada, the most important aspect of Islam is a salah. And as the Prophet ﷺ told us, that on the Day of Judgment, in the Sahih Hadith, that the first thing that the abd, that the slave will be questioned about on the Day of Judgment is what? Is a salah. And if that is in order, then the rest of his deeds will be in order. And if that is out of order, if that is wrong, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. So when something is that critical and that important, we have to learn it correctly, in the light of the Qur'an and the Sahih Ahadith. The manhaj of this dars is to learn the salah, not to argue, not to look at people's mistakes, but to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala correctly. In the light of the Qur'an and the Sahih Ahadith, benefiting from the manhaj of the Hanabila in the way of teaching, but from the aqwal of the Ahnaf, the Shawafi'a, the Malikiyah, the other madhahib as well, knowing what is their qawl, what is their dalil, so we can inshallah worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in what is the straight and the correct opinion, in the light of the strongest dalil, not in the darkness of just shutting ourselves in a room and saying this is one scholar and everything he says has to be right. No. Rather, we benefit from the framework of the madhahib, but in the light of the Qur'an and Sunnah. We don't want to be in silos just talking about this is what my Shaykh said. No. We want to look at the dalil for everything. So this is the bab on Sifatul Salah, how to pray the Salah itself.
So when we begin this,
فقال الموفق الدين ابن قدامة في العمدة إذا قام للصلاة قال الله أكبر ويجهر بها الإمام وبالسائر التكبير.
So he begins says that when one stands for the salah, he says Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, which we call at-takbir. And if it's in jama'ah, then the imam, he says it out loud. And that is the case with the rest of the takbirat. Every takbir in salah, the imam, he says it out loud. Now here I want to differentiate something. One is raf' al-yadain. Raf' al-yadain is raising the two hands. And one is التكبير وقول. يعني this is something you say. الله أكبر. So رفع اليدين is one thing and saying الله أكبر is a separate issue. First thing to be clear about that. Now Ibn قدامة he continues that why ليسمع من خلفه يعني لماذا يجهر الله أكبر بالتكبير الإمام ليسمع من خلفه. يعني why do a'imma say takbir out loud so that those behind him can hear. So this means that if you come to join a salah, the imam he says Allahu Akbar, he says it out loud. When you come, you say it, but you don't say it as loud as an imam does. You make jahr of it. It's not that you don't say it, but you make it so light that you hear it but others don't. Because one of the mistakes we see is when the imam is leading salah, especially like Dhuha or Asr, a brother will come and he will say, Allahu Akbar, and people are going to ruku. Because they don't know if the imam said it or somebody else said it. So this is not the way. Rather, you come, you say, Allahu Akbar, you don't think it, you articulate with the tongue, but loud enough for you to hear, but not others. But the imam, he has to say it loud for the people behind him to hear. Tayyib. This is called Takbiratul Ihram. And this is from the arkan of salah. Takbiratul ihram, making the first takbir, is a rukn. What does that mean, a rukn in salah? There are aspects of the salah that are arkan. They are pillars. They are obligatory. You must do them. And then there are aspects of the salah that are wajib. يعني واجبات الصلاه. There are 14 arkan. 8 wajibat, and inshallah all the students will memorize them by the end of the dars. Not today, but by the end of the dars, inshallah. And then there are sunan fi salah. Then there are things that are mustahab. And what is the difference, and why is it important for everybody here and everybody watching to memorize? Because this is something that can affect whether your salah is accepted or batil. Maqbool or batil. Limada. If you mess up a rukn in salah, then you have to repeat the rukn and make sujood sahw. If you mess up a wajib in salah, then you don't have to repeat the wajib, but you have to make sujood sahw. And if you mess up a sunan in salah, you don't have to repeat it and you don't have to make sujood sahw. If you mess up a rukn and you don't repeat it, your salah is batil. If you mess up a wajib knowingly and you don't make sujood sahw, your salah is batil. So these are very important things. And every one of us that makes salah, we make mistakes in life. Now if I was to ask all the brothers and sisters here, can you name me the arkan and wajibat? And I've already given you that there are 14 arkan and 8 wajibat. How many of you will be able to tell me from memory right now? Raise your hands. And this is why it's so important for us to study this dars. When we say we're going to study salah, everybody says, well, I already know how to make salah. But akhi, do you really know how to correctly make salah? Do you know why you're praying the way you're praying? Do you know if you make a mistake, how to correct that mistake? How many times we came to the masjid and the imam makes a mistake and unfortunately his correction is wrong? I'll give you an example. If you're sitting in your, if you make one rak'ah, and then you make a second rak'ah, and you don't sit for the first tashahud, in let's say dhuhr, 4 rak'ah salah. So you made a rak'ah, you made a second, you didn't sit, you got up for a third. And people said, Allahu Akbar, behind you, or Subhanallah. What do you do? Many a imma, they sit back down. But this is wrong. Because now you are standing in qiyam. This is a rukun. And when you make tark of a rukun on purpose, your salah is batil. Now you can't even make sujood sahwi, you have to make a new salah. What if you are making dhuhr, and in the last tashahud, instead of salam, you get up for a fifth rak'ah? Now people behind you say, Subhanallah, what do you do here? You sit down. Why? Because there's no fifth rak'ah. It's not a rukun. I'm just giving you an example of things that you might run into yourself. And even if you didn't understand that, by the end of these durus, inshallah, you will. But the point is, we need to learn our salah properly. And the hukam I gave you will be with dalil. With the action of the Prophet ﷺ himself, from Sahih Ahadith. It's not some, you know, alim sat somewhere and just thought up these issues and we're just reading a book. No. In the light of the Quran and Sahih Ahadith, inshaAllah ta'ala. When there is khilaf of madahib, we'll mention the khilaf as well. Regarding takbir ihram, there is no khilaf. All of the ulama of Islam, they believe that the salah is begun with the takbir. The imam says it out loud, and the people behind him, they articulate it, but not out loud like the imam. The opening takbir is a rukn in salah, and the dalil for this, and there are many ahadith, but I will mention a few of them, inshallah ta'ala. First is the hadith that is sahih, that Imam al-Tabrani has mentioned. Others, ulama, the ulama of takhrij have read it as sahih, as well as Shaykh Albani in Irwa al-Ghalil, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us that nobody's salah is accepted dun al-wudu, yani without wudu, or in the riwayah, dun al-tahara. And then when what should be done, yani what they should do, is to make the takbir, to say Allahu Akbar. It has also been reported by Abu Dawud with the wording from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, reporting that مفتاح الصلاة الطهور يعني the key to salah is purification يعني الوضوء تحريمها التكبير and the تحريم the beginning the opening of it or making haram literally and we'll discuss why we say that is التكبير والتحليلها التسليم and the ending of it or making halal of it is التسليم now this hadith As reported by Abu Dawud, again, it is a Sahih Hadith, as you can see in the book Sahih Abu Dawud. Why does it become a Dalil to show that the first Allahu Akbar is a Rukn, it's an obligatory, it's must. If it's not there, your salah is unaccepted. Why? Because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam connected it with Tahara. So now, I ask you, if you don't have Tahara, if you go and stand for Salah without wudu, is your Salah accepted? It's batil. So this is a dalil that if you don't make the takbir, then your salah is batil. It's not accepted. So if you're, you know, in your mindset, and you're thinking and you stand up for salah and you don't say Allahu Akbar to begin with, your salah is batil. This is from the arkan. And this also will become a dalil later on for the taslim, for saying assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaikum. In the different wording that has been recorded, we'll discuss that when we get to taslim. It's also obligatory, it's also a rukun. Why? Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam connected it with al-wudu or tahara. And this is reported in multiple ahadith. This is the opinion of the Hanafi madhab, the Ahnaf, as mentioned in Mukhtasar al-Quduri, the famous and well-known book of the Ahnaf. Also, the opinion of the Maliki madhab, as mentioned in Mukhtasar al-Khalil, the well-known book of the Maliki Madhab. Imam al-Nawawi, in his Al-Majmu'ah, discusses it in great detail with Dalail and shows it to be the Mu'tamid, or the relied upon opinion of the Shafi'i Madhab, and Al-Hajjawi in Al-Zad al-Mustaqni' and Ibn Qudama in all of his books from Umda and Kafi and Muqni' and Mughni has stated this to be the Mu'tamid of the Hanabila. So what does it show? That all of the madahib, the four well-known madahib, they agree on this. Ibn Hazm has also recorded this in Al-Muhalla, so the Zahiriya also agree on this issue. So we don't see any khilaf of ulama on this issue. Al-Sheikh Albani, rahmatullah alayh, in his book, Sifat al-Salat al-Nabi, he discusses al-Takbir. He says, Takbir al-Ihram means literally that the Takbir that makes things haram. How does it make it haram? Why do we call it Takbirat al-Ihram? Because the actions which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made halal outside of it are made haram by takbirat al-ihram. And the tasneem is called tahleel. It's called that which makes halal. Because then those actions again become halal. What does that mean? For example, if you're not making salah, can you talk to people? Is it halal to talk to people? Your mahram? Yes. Can you eat? If not fasting? Yes. Can you drink? If it's halal drink? Yes. Can you move around? Can you turn around? Can you look the other way? Yes. Can you laugh in consideration? Yes. So all of these things are halal. Can you shake hands with a brother? Yes. But once you say Allahu Akbar and you begin your salah, all of that which was halal outside of salah now became haram. That's why it's called takbiratul ihram. That which makes haram, that which was halal regularly. And this is very important because later on when we talk about wad'an, irsal, in salah and these things, you need to understand that there is a difference in state of outside of salah and inside of salah. So inside of salah, those things become haram after takbiratul ihram. And when you say assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah to your right and left, the tasneem, now it made those things halal again. Those things that were haram, now were made halal again. And that's why it's called tahleel. So now, when we understand that, we also see from those ahadith the dalil about takbirat al-ahram. When we look at books of hadith, when we talk about Sifat al-Salat al-Nabi, whether we talk about the book from Shaykh al-Bani or other books that have collected these kinds of hadith like Al-Bulugh al-Maram or Umdat al-Ahkam al-Kubra al-Sughra, they're all mentioned from Al-Bukhari and others that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam performed this. Every major book of hadith will have a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam making takbirat al-Ihram. So that also is a dalil that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never left this. It's also an additional dalil. To those qawli dalail, we also have fi'li dalail, the fi'l of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Many of the ulama, they have mentioned that there is ijma' on this issue. That there is a consensus that this is from the beginning of salah. Like Ibn Qudama and Al-Mughni has also discussed this saying, we don't know any khilaf on this issue. Now, what happens if somebody leaves out takbirat al-ihram on accident? One is to leave it out purposely, one is to leave it out on accident. So, since the takbirat al-ihram is a rukn or essential of the prayer, if a person leaves it out on purpose, like they're going out and they're thinking about stuff and they decide not to make takbirat al-ihram and they start their salah, then their salah is batil, and Ibn Qudama says, dun khilaf, yani we don't know khilaf on this. As Shaykh Muhammad Saleh ibn Uthaymeen was asked, if a person omits the opening takbir, takbirat al-ihram, by mistake, what is the hukam on this? He, rahmatullah alayh, he replied, he said, if a worshipper leaves out takbirat al-ihram by mistake or deliberately, his salah does not count. What does Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen say? That even if somebody leaves it out on accident, his salah is batil. Because the salah cannot begin without takbirat al-ihram. And if we assume that a person stands in a row that starts with the opening dua, يعني الدعاء الاستفتاح, and then الفاتحة, and he continues the prayer, we say that he has not even entered the salah to begin with. And all, even if he performs all the raka'at, his salah is batil. This is from Shaykh Muhammad Saleh ibn Uthaymeen. So now we see a very important point. There are some things in salah that if you left on accident, your salah would still be valid. But some things in salah, even if you left them on accident, if you realized it, I mean if you never realized it in your whole life, then we leave that with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you realized it, that salah is batil, now you have to repeat that salah. Ibn Qudama rahmatullah alayh, he continues and he says, وَرَفْعَ يَدَيْهِ عِنْدَ الْإِبْتِدَاءِ التَّكْبِيرِ إِلَى خُدُوا مَنْ كَبَيْهِ أَوْ إِلَى فُرُوعِ أُذْنِهِ. يعني, then he raises his hands close to his shoulders or to the earlobes or to the ends of the ear. Now we get into an issue of raising the hands. As I said, one issue is of saying Allahu Akbar. Another issue is raising the hands. One is the takbirat al-ihram, that is the recitation of Allahu Akbar. And another issue is raising of the hands. We do them together, but they're two different issues with two different ahkam. Tayyib. Awwalan, what is the hukam for saying Allahu Akbar to begin your salah? This is a rukun from the arkan of salah, without which, even if you leave it out deliberately or on accident, your salah is batil. Now, the issue of raising the actual hands, this is a separate issue. Now, this raf'u al-yadayn, this is something that is mustahab according to the ulama of Islam, actually raising the hands. Even though saying Allahu Akbar is different. Saying Allahu Akbar when you begin the salah is rukn from the arkan of salah. The rest of the takbirat, when you're going into ruku, when you're getting up, this is wajib from the wajibat of salah. But the raising of the hands, this is mustahab. Even if somebody was to forget this on accident, the salah would be perfectly fine. But nobody should leave it on purpose, because we know this to be the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-Shaykh Abdullah bin Abdul Rahman al-Bassam, in his sharh of Umdat al-Ahkam, the other book we're benefiting from, it's called Taysir al-Allam, sharh Umdat al-Ahkam, he writes, the ulema of Islam have reached ijma'. What does ijma' mean?
Consensus.
It doesn't mean jamhur, it doesn't mean majority, it doesn't mean a lot, it doesn't mean four madad, it means consensus that in a generation of this ummah, the mujtahideen of the ulama of this ummah, from all the madahib and everybody who is a mujtahid alim in this ummah, has agreed on this issue in a whole generation. With ijma' that this is an act of ibadah of the hands. Yani raising the hands in salah is an act of ibadah. It's an act of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in salah according to the ijma' of the ulama. And in searching from the hikam, from the wisdoms of this, some of the ulama of Islam have said, it is a means of zinatul salah, beautifying the prayer. These are very important things. Why? Because some people, they say, oh, you shouldn't raise the hands too much because you get distracted in the salah. Or this is not being calm in the salah. No, no. When it's established from the Prophet ﷺ, then this is not distraction, this is beautification. Many of the Salaf al-Salihin, and we'll discuss this when in the ruku' and raf'a minhu, when we talk about going to ruku' and raising, they said, the raising of the hands, this is the zina, this is the beautification of the salah. It raises the curtain, Shaykh Abdullah al-Bassam says, it raises the curtain of being unmindful, being ghafil, to being mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the mind of a slave. The moving of the body parts, yani moving of the hands, is a means to activate the heart and to increase its khushu' towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Imam al-Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi said that this is a glorification, an exalting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as demonstrated by the hands, and it was demonstrated that this is the love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in following his sunnah. So when you say Allahu Akbar, by your tongue, you're praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you raise the hands, by your hands, you're glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Shafi'i says, this is glorifying Allah, and also it is showing a love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because obedience to his sunnah. We also know from the hadith that is hasan, it is a reliable hadith, that Uqba bin Amir and others have reported from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in marfu' form and mawquf form, yani from the wording of the sahabi and from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that for every rafa', every time you make a rafa' in salah, you get 10 rewards. For every finger, there's a reward. The sahih hadith, hasan hadith, maqbool. So what does that tell you? That when you make rafa' al-yadayn, when you begin your salah, how many rewards do you get? 10 rewards. Now, when you're going into ruku', if you make raf'u al-yadayn, how many rewards you get then? 10. Now you got 20. When you get up from ruku' and you raise your hands again, how many do you get now? Another 10. So you got 30. Now, if you just start raising your hands the whole time in salah, no. Because you have to follow the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But if you know that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made these takbirat and then you leave them, you will be losing 10 rewards for every raf'ah that is established from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So imagine those people that make the first takbir, but they don't make it going into ruku' or getting up from ruku'. In every raka'ah, they're losing how many rewards? 20 rewards per raka'ah. For who? Why? Whoever wants this hadith, inshallah, I'll furnish it for them. So, we know from the ulama of Islam, they've come to a consensus that is mustahab, that it is sunnah to raise the hands when saying takbiratul ihram. Ibn al-Mundari in his Awsat says, none of the people of ilm disagreed that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam raised his hands when he started the prayer. Yet there is differences about how high. Some of the ulama of Islam, they said to raise it up to where your ear level is. Not to touch the ears. I don't know of any hadith that mentions touching the ears. But to raise it to the level of the ears. And some of the ulama of Islam, they said, also based on hadith, to raise it to the level of the shoulders. Now, it is both of these are based upon authentic narrations. So in the Sharh of Al-Umda, Imam Bahauddin Al-Maqdisi, he mentions that the dalil for this is the hadith where Abdullah ibn Umar, radiallahu anhuma, he says, that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he opened the prayer with takbir, raising his hands to the level of his shoulders at the time of saying takbir. And this hadith is in Al-Bukhari. It is a sahih hadith reported in Al-Bukhari. So Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he reports the hadith that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he raised his hands to the level of his shoulders. Muttafaqun alayh, there is no doubt. So if anybody raises their hands to the level of their shoulders when beginning the salah, there is no problem with this. This is established from authentic hadith. It is also reported by Malik ibn Huwayrith radiallahu anhu from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he raised his hands to the level of his ears at the time of reciting the takbir. Now this hadith is a sahih Muslim. It's not in al-Bukhari, but it's also a sahih hadith from Malik ibn Huwayrith radiallahu anhu. Now, some of the ulama, they took the hadith of Malik bin Huwayrith and they said, you raise the hands up to the level of the ears. A hadith in Sahih Muslim, if somebody does this, there's no problem with this. Some of the ulama, they took the hadith of Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma and other ahadith and they said, because it's muttafaqun alayh, it is stronger because it's, as we know in the grading of hadith, those ahadith that both Bukhari and Muslim agree on are stronger, even though neither one of them is da'if. But they are stronger than the ones only in Muslim. So they said it's better you raise it to the level of the shoulders. Other ulama, they said you do it in the middle. And you try to cover both. But that really just kind of makes a third way. Doesn't really cover either one then. But Ibn Qudama here, he promotes a very balanced view. He said if Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam raised it to the shoulders, and we know this from Bukhari and Muslim, we have to follow this. And if we know that he also raised it to the level of his ears, and we know this from Sahih Muslim, nothing wrong with this either. If Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did both, why do we have to reject one? If one was weak and one was strong, if one was against the other, it would have been a different issue. But we don't have that issue. So the strongest opinion is, you can do either one. Raise them to the level of your shoulders, or to the level of your earlobes. And either one of these is perfectly fine because they're established from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-Sheikh Albani rahmatullah alayhi, he also writes, he says, he sallallahu alaihi wasallam would raise them, yani his hands, with his fingers apart, not spaced out and not squished together, like this. And he would raise them to the level of his shoulders, although occasionally he would raise them to the level of his ears. And to do this is perfectly fine. What does that mean? That means that if we look at the majority of the ahadith and the strongest of salat, they're to the shoulders. But there are those that are higher. So he said sometimes the Rasulullah will raise it higher, but usually up to the shoulders. One thing also important is that the palms should be facing the qibla. Many people, they say Allahu Akbar, like this. And their hands are like this. This is not correct. Your hands should be like this, not like this, and not like this. Spaced gently. الشيخ محمد صالح بن عثيمين also supported this view after discussing the evidences in detail in شرح الممتع على زاد المستقنع and the Greek scholar Imam al-Khiraqi, the one who wrote مختصر al-Khiraqi, the first matan of the Hanabila, also supported this view. And if we look at the majority of the ulama, they will support this view as well. And in مختصر al-Khiraqi he says, when saying the takbir, one may raise his hands up to the shoulders or the ears. Imam Nuruddin, he writes in his sharh al-Wadih, fi sharh al-Khiraqi, if someone acts upon what has been reported from Ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma and raises his hand to the shoulders, this is good. And if somebody raises the hands to the ears, as has been reported by others, yani Malik bin Huwayrat and others, this is also fine. And al-Wadih fi sharh al-Mukhtasar al-Khiraqi, one of the classic shuruh of al-Khiraqi, and this is the mu'tamid of the madhab, wallahu a'lam. Now when somebody has said takbir, they said Allahu Akbar and they raised their hand. What do they do then? Is to fold the hands. And then when we discuss the issue of folding the hands, this is the issue that has come under a lot of debate and a lot of argument in our time. So inshallah, next week we will discuss this issue in detail about how to fold the hands, where to fold the hands, what is the khilaf between the different madahib, what are the dalail, and what is the qawl al-rajih. Inshallah ta'ala, we encourage all the students to have istiqama in the durus and be here from the beginning till the end, so each dars develops on the next, so we can learn our salah in the light of the Quran, the sahih ahadith, with the aqwal of the madahib, knowing what is right from wrong, and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has shown us. Jazakum Allahu khairan.
فقد نصره الله